Today we're going to be talking about how horizontal temperature differences play a role in driving vertical circulations that can potentially support thunderstorm development, provide that ingredient of lift that supports thunderstorms. And these temperature differences can be driven by land-sea interfaces and differential heating rates, slope terrain, for instance, where we get elevated heat sources, provide the impetus for these vertical circulations that support the development of thunderstorms. We're going to start by talking about the horizontal temperature differences that arise from differential heating rates, and say this is a poorly drawn sketch of Florida. Let's kind of adjust this a little bit, not drawn to scale over here. Florida Keys here, and say we're dealing with the diurnal heating cycle. Here's the sun as it comes out, Atlantic waters and the Gulf waters over here. We know that the heat capacity of water is around four times that of the land areas. And so when the sun comes out, the land areas are going to heat up much more so, much faster rate than over the surrounding waters. And as a result, we're seeing that the temperature change over the land areas is going to be far more sensitive to the solar input, the solar radiation input, than over the water areas because of the differential heat capacity. And so we're going to have a much more abrupt increase in temperatures over the land areas than we have over the waters. Temperatures will stay nearly similar over the water locations than the air temperatures over land. And as a result, with temperatures increasing, the molecules of air over the land areas are going to be effectively energized substantially more. There's much more kinetic energy. They're going to be moving faster, dispersing more and more. And so density, the lower atmosphere, will be decreasing. And as a result, pressure will be decreasing as well over the land areas, density staying nearly the similar values over the waters, and pressure similar values over the waters. And so as a result, we get effectively something over the land areas that appears to be a thermal low begin to evolve over the land compared to over the water locations. Again, that's because the temperature, the heating rates are going to be much more sensitive over land as we're dealing with a much lower heat capacity, four times lower over land than over the water locations. And so as a result, we get a pressure gradient force that is directed inland compared to relatively higher pressure over the Gulf of over the Atlantic Ocean, Gulf of Mexico, for instance, as you can see over here. And as a result, we have a flux of mass that is directed inland from the water locations, just like this over here. And at the leading edge of that flux of cooler, denser, higher pressure air emanating over the waters inland, we get a convergence band that forms along coastal areas and extends inland. That's called a sea breeze. It's associated with a vertical circulation, a zone of ascent, where we potentially get storms form if the ascent extends deep enough such that parcels can get to the levels of free convection and potentially have the development of thunderstorms if other conditions are met, as we talked about throughout this class. This sea breeze boundary is going to be critical. With time, convective outflows, rain-cooled air will merge with the sea breeze boundary and potentially accelerate its inland advance, and we get storms effectively cluster increasingly over interior sections of the Florida Peninsula. This sea breeze boundary exists across many other coastal interfaces as well. During the nighttime, I'll draw a moon over here to indicate what's going on at night. And you can see here Florida Peninsula, and here's the Panhandle, here are the Keys. And we're going to be having much more substantial cooling rates over the land areas and over the water owing to the differential heat capacity. So we're going to be much more sensitive to temperature changes over here with outgoing long-wave radiation. Over here across the inland areas, driving much lower or a much stronger cooling rate, a higher density over land, higher pressure over land compared to over the water locations, which drives a relatively higher area, or I should say an area of higher pressure over the interior sections of the state, for instance, driving an outward directed pressure gradient force across the water locations. And you can see similar to what we have during the daytime, will end up forming a convergence band at the leading edge of that colder air that's going to be extending outward from the land areas, and that is called a land breeze boundary. And that can sometimes be a focus for thunderstorm development at night. But the difference between the sea breeze boundary and its propensity for thunderstorm development during the daytime compared to the land breeze boundary at night is that during the day, when we have the land areas heat up more substantially, we're having much more buoyancy provided, much more erosion of inhibition, and so the thermodynamic character over the land areas is going to be more favorably phased with that ascent associated with the sea breeze boundary in support of storm development, whereas that buoyancy is not going to be as favorable over water locations at night, for instance, owing to the smaller changes in temperature over the water than over the land. And as a result, once that convergence boundary extends over the water areas, we're going to have less propensity for storm development owing to smaller buoyancy aligning with that boundary compared to over land areas during the day. So now let's consider and what's going on over the mountain areas. We know that mountains can sometimes be a source for thunderstorm development, or at least individual locations where thunderstorm development is favored. But what exactly is going on in support of these differences in heating rates that could potentially support the development of thunderstorms over mountains? Well, let's consider a mountain slope over here. We'll consider during the daytime, sun comes out. Here's our mountain slope over here. And in the atmosphere, we know that background density decreases as we go up through the atmosphere. Gravity is pulling all the air molecules down. They bunch up in the lowest part of the atmosphere, closest to the ground, and density is much higher near the ground, and then decreases as we go higher in the atmosphere. So with the sun coming out during the daytime, we know that we're going to have relatively similar input of solar radiation along the slope of the mountain. It's not going to vary tremendously as we go along the mountain slope. We're going to have similar input of solar radiation, insolation, incoming solar radiation along this mountain slope, up high as down low. But the difference lies in the density along that slope. Lower density up high, higher density down low. So as a result, we're going to have fewer molecules of air up here that are going to be experiencing the same amount of solar radiation. So with the same input of solar radiation, we're going to be able to heat up much faster, higher along the mountain than down low. There's going to be we're going to be much more sensitive to the incoming solar radiation in terms of heating up the top of the mountain than we are at the bottom of the mountain slope. And so as a result, we're going to be driving, again, a density difference now, not along this flat surface, but along this sloped surface over here, such that our density will be falling much faster up high than down low. We're going to have relative lower pressure. Pressures will be falling much more so up high along the mountain slope than down low. And instead of having our pressure gradient force extend during the day, for instance, with our sea breeze circulation, just along our horizontal surface, we're going to go along our sloped surface over here towards the stronger pressure falls towards the top of the mountain, where we have stronger heating rates owing to relatively less density towards the top of the mountain, much stronger temperature increases at that elevated heat source over here, driving a flux of air up the mountain slope that is providing that circulation over here, orographic circulations that are associated with that upslope flow, associated with the possibility of that lift extending high enough towards the level of free convection for thunderstorm development. If we have enough moisture present, and we're able to potentially get the development of storms from these elevated heat sources, as you can see here, owing again to this difference in density, in this case for the sea breeze circulation over here, lower density over land, land breeze, lower density over the water locations, over here, top of the mountain, elevated heat source that's driving that upslope flow over here, and then which is what we call an anabatic flow, and then at night we'll have relatively higher density store up at the top of the mountain, which will descend down the slope into katabatic flow, and we'll have downslope flow favored at night. the main point here is that these differences in density that could be favored by differential heating or differential cooling rates across land surfaces or between land and water can drive the ascent ingredient, the lift ingredient necessary for thunderstorm development in some cases. Sometimes we'll have a storm develop over a mountain location, and then that storm will advance off the mountain, potentially encountering higher inhibition over the lower elevations. This is sometimes an issue in Montana where I get storms form over the northern Rocky Mountain Front Range vicinity, and those storms would then move off the terrain, encounter higher inhibition over the lower elevations, potentially where there's less lift, and storms would dissipate, or sometimes they will intensify as they encounter relatively higher buoyancy over the lower elevations. So we have to consider the thermodynamic profiles, particularly that these storms will be encountering as they develop. Sometimes storms will have developed and then interact with these orographic circulations that could potentially result in influencing their character, their behavior, their intensity, and their structure. And so all of these much smaller scale circulations can play a major role, not only in terms of supporting storm development, but affecting storms that have already occurred. And now the next thing we're going to be talking about is the mathematical derivations behind these vertical circulations, what's going on in the theoretical side in terms of how we can use mathematics to illustrate these vertical circulations that support the development of storms.